got to make one of the announcements, doing pretty good at messing up today, is that lilies, if you want a lily for next Sunday to decorate the sanctuary, then to take home, the lilies, the forms are in the back, and they can still get them, and you can pay next week. $6 a lily if you want to do it in honor or in memory of someone that she's in the best you do. I want to read from Mark chapter 10 this morning as we think about one of the most holiest times of the year. Mark chapter 10, verse 32 through 34. Now they were on the road going up to Jerusalem, and Jesus was going before them, and they were amazed, and they followed, they were afraid. Then Jesus took the 12 aside. Again, and began to tell them the things that would happen to him. He took the 12 aside again. And he began to tell them, this is what's going to happen. Behold, we are going up to Jerusalem. Listen to the detail. We are going up to Jerusalem. And the Son of Man will be betrayed to the chief priests and the scribes. And they will condemn him to death and deliver him to the Gentiles. And they will mock him, scourge him, and spit on him, and kill him. And the third day, the Son of Man will rise again. That's the good news. On the third day, he will rise again. Isn't it good to know the end of the story before we get started? I love it. We got it in Revelation 2. We win. Let's pray. Father, I pray that you will anoint me to bless your people here today with the good news of Jesus Christ. And this story that is so important. The story of your life for each one of us. Lead us by your Holy Spirit, I pray, in Jesus' name. Let all age groups, let all people be touched through this in Christ's name. Amen. I have a favorite professor at the Billy Graham Training Center that I've gone to several of his seminars now, and I've already signed up for one next June. And I look forward to it. This is one of those professors that's not over your head, and that would be hard to be with me. But I'm going to tell you, he just teaches in such a way. Last year we did the book of Galatians, and we spent, I don't know how many hours in the book of Galatians, 6 chapters. But I came away with them with a fresh new understanding about God's grace. And this year it's going to be on Philippians, the joy that we have in Christ. But anyway, one of his sayings last year that really touched me is that when you come to the Bible is God's grand design. It is his narrative. And you want to think about a narrative? There's no better narrative in all the world than the narrative that you and I have from Genesis to Revelation. It's God's design, his story that's unfolding. I remember years ago, there was this preacher, he's going to be with the Lord now, Chuck Smith of Calvary Chapel, who started Calvary Ministry out in California. He said it's his story. It's history, but it's his story. Amen? And it's all history to him because he knows the beginning from the end. And so it's just amazing as you go from the book of Genesis all the way through Revelation. God is unfolding how he is working in human history, how he is revealing himself, his plans, and how he is at work. And you know, today, what we're going to be doing is looking at one pinnacle. I have said for many times, this is the climax. But it's only one part of the climax. Because the story of the narrative is still running. It's not finished. As you look at a world that looks like it's going awry, and things are out of control, remember this. God is still writing the narrative. He knows what's going to happen. Amen. And we can rest in His sovereignty. He is in charge. Even the ends have been already predestined. I believe that will follow my Father. The ultimate character in this story is Jesus. And from the very beginning of time, He was God with God in creation. And He will be with you in the very end. When He comes back, not riding on a donkey, but riding on a white horse. He's not coming in peace. He's coming as a king. Eternal and conquered. Today, what I want to do is invite your children forward to try something new today. And I don't know how it's going to work. And I've asked some people to give me some feedback. But I want, if you're 4 to 15 years old, this might be a little young for some of you. But come on up here and sit on the front row. Or on the front. Right here. Whatever it's called, the floor. Yeah, give me some room for work. And we're going to go through part of this narrative, this story, next. You want to come over this way a little bit so you can see the screen. The best is bigger. And Terry, would you turn off the lights? I think that lights out. I don't think we're going to need them to read. Let me get caught up, guys. Let's see if Daniel's got caught up. He might be able to read. Okay, I'll wait for Daniel. The first Easter. Oh my God. How are you guys doing today?
Good.
Good. Okay. We've got a lot of older guys up here today. Well, I will do my best to, I thought really Miss Trudy would be best in telling this story today because she has such a gift in telling this. But let's go. This is a Bible story for children, and many of y'all, you're big children. But we're going to just, this is still one of, it is the greatest story that's ever been told, guys. And it's for all people. This story is for you. It's for me. It's for your parents, your grandparents, your great whoever. It's for your neighbors. This is for everyone because this story is about our Lord. Okay, let's go to the one, a lady. There was a lady that stood on a noisy hillside one day. Her sad eyes were looking up to a terrible scene. What do you think she was seeing? Her son was dying. Can you imagine this lady looking up there on this, and it was very noisy, crowds of people all around, and there was a terrible thing she was seeing. Her son on a cross dying. Can you imagine? Next one. Do you know her name? Mary. Mary was looking up at her son, and she stood near the place where Jesus was as he was dying. He had been nailed to a cross. Can you imagine such a terrible thing? Just days earlier, he had ridden into Jerusalem, and they were waving and shouting, "Hosanna, you're the king! You're the king!" And now he's dead. He's dying on a cross. He'd been nailed to a cross. How did all this happen? How did it change so quickly, guys? How could Jesus end up in such a beautiful life and such an awful time? It doesn't seem right, does it? Are things fair in this world? Does everybody help others and bless them? No. How did it all happen? How could God allow? Look at the question marks on the cross. How could God allow this to happen, such a terrible thing? For his son, Jesus, to be nailed to a cross, to die there. Did Jesus make a mistake about who he was? Did God fail? When you look at the cross, that's kind of amazing, isn't it, that God would do that to his own son? Why would he do that? No. God didn't fail. Does God ever fail? No. I'll tell you one thing God can't do, that's fail. God, wouldn't it be great if you had that in class? God doesn't fail.
Jesus hadn't made any mistake. Jesus always knew, class, that he was going to die. That wicked men would put him to death. Even when Jesus was a baby, there was a man in the temple that held him in his arms and told his mother and dad, "Something one day is going to pierce your heart like a sword, and it's going to be very tragic and very sad." A few days before Jesus was killed, a lady came and poured perfume on his feet and got him ready for his death and his burial. Her name is Mary. And she came in to where Jesus was at the table, and she took some very expensive perfume and she poured it on his feet, just so lovingly and compassionately, because she knew that Jesus was going to die for us. And she had a heart of compassion. She's wasting the money, the disciples complained. She's done a good work, Jesus said. Leave her alone. She did it for my burial. What strange words. After this, Judas went and made a deal with the chief priest and the leaders, the religious leaders. He agreed to betray Jesus for what? 30 pieces of silver. He betrayed him. You ever been betrayed by a friend, someone hurt you really bad? For 30 pieces of silver. And then, at the Jewish Passover, Jesus had his last supper with his disciples, and he told them some wonderful things about God. And do you know what he did at that last supper? He took bread and he took a cup of wine. And he said, "This is my body that is given for you, and this is the new covenant in my blood." He told them what he was going to do. "I'm going to lay down my life for each of you on the cross." Isn't God good? Then Jesus gave bread and cup to each of them to share. And these were to remind them that Jesus' body and blood were given to bring forgiveness for our sins. I want to ask you, do you know what sin is? It's all the things that we do wrong. And we've all got it. I do, you do, your parents, your grandparents. The Bible says we've all sinned. And Jesus stood that night saying this: "What I'm about to do with the bread and the cup, I will die on the cross that your sins can be forgiven." And that's good news, isn't it? Let's see what happens. Then Jesus told his friends that he would be betrayed and they would run away. "I won't run away," said Peter. Jesus said, "Before the rooster crows, you will deny me 3 times. You think that's going to happen? Let's go on. Later that night, Jesus went to the Garden of Gethsemane. And this was right at the foot of the Mount of Olives. And there he prayed. And do you know what he prayed, guys? Do you think he wanted to go through with this terrible thing at the cross? No. He asked his Father, "Dear God, if there's any way possible, take this from me. But if it's what I've got to do, I will do it." And he prayed that 3 times. And the Bible says his sweat was like blood falling to the ground. But an angel came and strengthened him. Next, "Oh my Father," Jesus prayed, "let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will." And so he prayed and he prayed. And then when he got done praying, you know what happened? Somebody came leading a mob. Judas had made a deal with the religious leaders: "The one I kiss will be Jesus. Hand me the 30 pieces of silver." He went up to Jesus and he kissed him on the cheek. And the mob arrested Jesus. And do you know what Peter did? One of Jesus' disciples had a sword. He took the sword, he drew it out of the sheath or whatever it is, and he sliced off one of the soldier's ears. Now, Jesus, you know what Jesus did?
He healed the man's ear. The man that was going to take him to prison and have him killed, he put the ear back on. That's pretty neat, isn't it? I don't know if I'd do that. I'd probably take the other one too. Sorry, that wasn't very nice. So the mob, just being real, so the mob took Jesus to the high priest's house. And there the Jewish leaders said Jesus should die. The Jewish leaders hated Jesus. The Bible says they hated him without cause. And near God stood Peter outside by a fire just to kind of see what was going on. And people recognized him. And three times people stared at Peter and they said, "Oh, you were with him. You're one of the Galileans." Three times Peter denied it. "I didn't know him." He even said some bad things. What happened? Cock-a-doodle-doo! What did Jesus say would happen when you deny me three times? The rooster will crow. Cock-a-doodle-doo! It's like God was speaking to Peter and said, "Remember?" Just then a rooster crowed. It was God's voice to Peter, remembering Jesus' words. And Peter was so sad. He cried bitterly. Judas was sorry too. I don't like this part. Judas was sorry too. He knew that Jesus was not guilty. He had not done anything wrong. He tried to give the money back to the religious leaders. They wouldn't take it. "We made a deal. You keep it." He threw it down. And you know what he did? He went out and hung himself. Terrible thing. You know what they did? The priest then took Jesus to the governor, to Pilate. And Jesus stood before Pilate, the Roman governor, and Pilate said, "You know what? I have tried every way I can to find something wrong. There's nothing wrong with this man. He hasn't done anything wrong." He wanted to let him go, and his wife even warned him in a dream, "Have nothing to do with this man." But you know what? The mob kept crying. What did they cry, guys? Anybody remember? Let's do it together. "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Now, come on, y'all can do better now. Let's do it. "Crucify! Crucify!" They were yelling, "Crucify." It's funny how crowds can be worked up. I think they still are today. Finally, Pilate gave in. And you know what he had? Jesus. He turned him over to the soldiers. And the soldiers took him in, and they beat him. And this really doesn't tell us how bad it was. But the Bible tells us in Isaiah 52 that when they got done beating Jesus with a whip, but had sharp fragments of bone and glass on the end of it, a short whip, and he was tied to a stump, that his body was beyond human likeness. They ripped him apart, his back. They punched him, they spit in his face, they wouldn't. Let me ask you something. Did your parents ever tell you never to spit on anybody? I thought about that. My dad always said, "You don't ever spit on anybody." Why? Because that's disrespectful, isn't it? Yeah, that's a bad thing, isn't it? Okay, what's your question? At school, somebody spits, well, you shouldn't spit, should they? So, okay, let's move on, okay? So they spit in Jesus' face, they whipped him, they beat him, they whipped a crown of thorns. And you know, when you look it up, the thorns were over an inch long, and they made this crown, and they pressed it on Jesus' head. Can you imagine? I hate pain. I don't like to get a little deal. Can you imagine all that Jesus was willing to go through for your life? And so they put that crown of thorns, they pressed it on his head, and they took him out, and they crucified him. They knew that we're going to get rid of this Jesus guy. But I want to ask you, can you get rid of God? No, you can't do away with God, can you? People have tried all throughout history. Jesus always knew that he would die that way on the cross. He also knew that his death would bring forgiveness for sinners who put their trust in him. Two criminals were crucified beside Jesus. One believed on Jesus and the other one didn't. And one went to paradise that day and the other one, he's spoken.
After hours of suffering. You know what time Jesus was nailed to the cross, guys? 9 o'clock in the morning. You know what time he finally died? 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And from 12 to 3, the Bible tells us that darkness covered the land. The sun stopped shining. And at 3 o'clock, Jesus bowed his head. And he said, "It is finished. I've done all that God's asked me to do. That now mankind can be forgiven and have eternal life." And he died. His work was completed. Friends buried him in a private tomb. The Roman soldiers sealed and guarded the tomb. Now nobody else could get in or get out. They look like pretty big soldiers, don't they? Can you hold God in? Can you keep him down? If this were the end of the story, how sad it would be. But God did something wonderful. Jesus did not stay dead. Is that good or not? Early in the morning on the first day of the week, this is what we get to celebrate next week, is the resurrection. Some of Jesus' disciples found that the stone had been rolled away from the grave. When they looked inside, Jesus was no longer there. One woman stayed crying by the tomb. Jesus appeared to her and rushed back joyfully to tell the other disciples, "Jesus is alive." Let's say that together. Jesus is alive. Let's say it together. Jesus is alive. He has come back from the dead. And that's the story of the Bible. Soon Jesus came to his disciples. He showed them his nail-scarred hands. And it was true. Jesus was alive again. He forgave Peter for denying him. He told his disciples to tell everybody about him. And he went back to heaven where he'd come from. Boys and girls, that's the first Easter that ever took place, where God showed his love for you and I by giving his only son, Jesus. Jesus loves every one of you. And he did what he did on the cross for every one of us. Don't ever forget that. That's the central story of the whole Bible. For God so loved every one of us, he gave Jesus for you and I to die in our place for our sins on that cross. And the moment you and I accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior, our names are written in his book. God has a book. You know what that book is called? The Lamb's Book of Life. And the moment you accept Jesus in your heart, God writes your name in this book. And one day he's going to open that book. Honey, don't talk to me. One day he's going to open that book and he's going to look for your name and for mine. And we want to be sure that our name is in that book. How do we get it there? We ask Jesus to come into our heart. If you've never done that, that's the most important decision you'll ever make in your life. And many of you have done that, and maybe some of you haven't. How do I ask Jesus in my heart? By a little prayer. Father, forgive me of my sins. I believe that Jesus died on that cross for me and that he's alive. And I want Jesus to live in my heart. Come today. And he will. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for each of these young people that are here today, from the youngest to the oldest. And I pray the work of the Holy Spirit in each of their hearts and minds, that you would bring